Everyone, welcome back to Learn Piano with Mr. Frank. I'm excited because this is video number two, and we're going to be exploring the finger position that we're going to be working in to get started in playing piano. In our last video, we learned all about this keyboard geography and where all the notes are. So if you haven't watched that video, make sure you find lesson one. It's a fairly long video, but it will really get you acclimated with where all the keys on your keyboard are. Okay, but today we're going to learn about what we call the C5 finger position. The C5 finger position gets us set up so that we can play some very basic, very easy pieces of music just to get us started. So how do we get there? Well, first thing we need to do is find the note C. We know by now that all our notes are named with letters of the alphabet, right? A through G. We're going to be focusing on C through G for a while. Don't worry about A and B just yet. So let's think about C. C is going to kind of be our home base for a little while. How do we find C on our keyboard? Well, you see that I have the little note, names of the notes up here. I don't want you to rely on this too much. It's going to be helpful for a little while, but I want you to memorize where these notes are going to be. So I'm going to tell you how to find C. The easiest way is look at the black notes, not the white notes, okay? Now, C is going to be a white note, but I want you to look at the black notes and find the pattern. You see that there are two black notes, then three black notes, then two black notes, and then this would be three black notes. And if I zoomed out, you would see that the entire keyboard has that same pattern. So let's find in the middle of your keyboard, as close to the middle as you can find, your keyboard or your piano, two black notes next to each other. Okay? Now I want you to find the note that's on the left and then move down to the white key just to its left. I'll say that again. Two black notes together. The black key on the left, find the white key to its left. And that's going to be the note C. And the cool thing about the piano is it's just made up of patterns all the way up and down the piano. So if you can find this C, you can find a C elsewhere on your piano. For example, this one here. Right? You've got these two black notes. Look for the white note directly to the left. And there is your C. We call those octaves. Right? They should sound the same when they're played together, except one will be lower pitch than the other. And we can do that all the way down our keyboard, right? All the way up and down the keyboard. I know you can't see it right now, but there are many different C's on your keyboard. So for now, we're focusing on the one that's in the middle of your keyboard. Now we found C. That's going to be where your right thumb is going to live. Okay, and remember what we talked about in the last video. Don't play it like this with the pad of your thumb because that doesn't allow your other fingers to be on your keyboard. So we're going to play with the side of your thumb like this. This allows your other fingers to be right here. Remember to always play with a nice curved hand for mobility. So C, D, our next note, lives between C, between these two black notes, right? D. And then, of course, next would be E on the right side. F lives here, and G would live here. Now, we learned about this in our last video, but now we're going to be able to put our fingers to those notes. So thumb, pointer on D, middle finger on E, ring finger on F, and pinky on G. All right, so you should have some nice mobility there. We're going to do the same thing with our left hand, but because our hands are mirror images of each other, we're going to reverse it. Instead of our left thumb being on C, we're going to put our left pinky on C. All right? And then our ring finger on D, middle finger E, pointer finger F, and thumb on G. Again, using that side of the thumb. So your hand should look like this when you're done. Okay? Now that we've got all that, let's take a look at our music. Now, it's very important that you understand that our music is not going to look like this. These notes kind of look like the notes that we're going to be using, but it certainly won't have the letter names like C, D, E, F, G. We're going to have a different system of notation for being able to read those notes. But for now, we're just trying to get everybody acclimated to the keyboard and playing basic stuff. So our music won't look like this. You may finish playing this song and say, oh boy, playing piano or reading music is a lot easier than I thought it would be. Well, the truth is, it's definitely not going to be this easy. There is more to it. But I still know every one of you can do it. RH is going to stand for right hand, making LH stand for left hand. We won't see that either once we get to music notation. But for now, when you see an RH, know that your right hand is going to play all of this music. And then the next line will be LH, and we're going to play all of this music. Okay, remember that we read music from left to right, just like you would read a book. And then when you get to the end of a line, go down to the next line and start again and read across all the way to the double bar. This double bar signifies the end of a piece of music or a section of a piece of music. Now, we have these areas here where we're going to put notes. And you'll see that these areas are interrupted by these little vertical lines that aren't notes, they're just lines. That divides music into what we call measures. All right? And a measure is going to contain an equal amount of beats as the next measure, until the music tells us otherwise. In this case, we can find four beats in a measure. This note is called a quarter note, and it equals one beat. We talked about that last time, but just to review, each one gets one beat. What's one beat? Whatever we want to make it. So in this case, let's set this tempo meaning speed, and each one of these snaps will be one beat, right? Beat, 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 beat. So every time I play one of these notes, C, D, E, and F, we'd have one beat. When we get to our next measure, this also contains four beats, right? We counted one, two, three, four. Our half note receives double what a quarter note gets, two beats. So two of these will equal four beats. One, two, one, two, or one, two, and then three, four. So to play these G's, we'd play one, two, three, four, right? It's actually math. It makes a lot of sense. It's basic elementary school math. These numbers up here are for which fingers to use, but you don't really need that, because if you know the C5 finger position and your thumb is on C, you'll automatically know where to put your fingers. It should be very easy. So you really don't have to look at this right now. Later on, that this will become more important. And it's important that you know that not every note is going to have a finger number. And in more advanced music, when we get there, you won't have finger numbers at all. You're just going to know what to do. You won't have to worry about it. Okay, so it's time to play our first piece of music, Etude in C. And like it says here, Etude is a French word meaning study or an exercise. You're going to see a lot of Etudes in this book. You'll know that it's just not a full piece of music. It's a little, you know, a study or an exercise. Here we go, Etude in C. We'll get our hands in position, remembering to put our thumb on the C, which again is to the left of these two black notes, and your pinky of your left hand on that C. Curving your fingers, sitting up straight, posture is super important. And I'm going to play it for you once first, so don't play it with me. I want you to watch this time, and then we'll play it together after. I'm going to count every song we play off with a full measure. So I'll usually say one, two, ready, play. Okay, four beats. One, two, ready, play. And then you'd start playing on the first beat of that next measure. Here I go. One, two, ready, play. Easy, right? So the right hand again plays that first line, and the left hand is going to play that bottom line. Now it's time for you to play along with me, okay? So let's get ready. I'm excited. It's our first little virtual duet here. So our right hand and our left hand set up, curved, of course, right? Make sure that your thumb of your right hand is on C, all your other fingers follow. And the same thing, your pinky on C, all your other fingers follow. And play along with me. Remember, the black quarter notes equal one beat, and the open half notes get two beats. Here we go. One, two, ready, play. Switch to your left hand. Easy, right? How'd you do with that? I'll bet you did great. But we're always going to make some mistakes, especially early on. So practice, practice, and more practice. So for the purposes of this video, we'll play it together one more time, and then I want you guys, once the video is over, to just practice it and practice it. And one of my students just came up with this saying one day, and I wish I could remember her name, but she wrote it on my whiteboard years ago, and I've used it ever since. And the saying was, practice until it's impossible to get it wrong. And I love that, because that's what making music is all about, is perfecting it. Just like an athlete would work at maybe a basketball player making a foul shot, or a baseball player and hitting the ball square on the bat. Whatever it is that you set out to do in your life, if you practice it enough, if you work at it enough, it becomes that much more easy to achieve. So it's certainly true for playing piano. So practice, practice, practice. Here we go. Let's do it one more time together. Hands are in position. And here we go. One, two, ready, play. Now the left hand. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. And of course, remember, when we're making this music, you're always in your head counting the number of beats that are in each measure. Later on, there'll be a symbol that's going to tell us how many beats in each measure. But now we can see, right, that there are four beats. One, two, three, four. So in your head, you're always counting. Some people like to tap their foot. For a piano, it might not be the best idea, because once we start using the pedal, you won't be able to do that. But always in your head, be thinking one, two, three, four. So you count in that you're not getting ahead. All right. Some people like to use a metronome, which is a little device that plays a click. I have one here I can show you. Right. And you could set that click to go faster or slower. And it's a good way to practice, but I don't want you to get in too much of a habit of using that, because some people, you know, start to depend on it to be there. I want to start us out without that metronome, so that you can get your own internal metronome and do it in your own head. If you ever need it and you have one on your keyboard or near your piano, you can certainly use it. I know you can get an app on any phone, a free metronome. Just, you know, do a search in the App Store or Google Play, whatever you might be using, and you'll find a metronome that you can use for free. Okay, everybody, that is lesson number two, and I'm so happy you joined me today. I hope you did well, and if you're still struggling, go back in the video and play again. And remember, practice until it's impossible to get it wrong. All right, I'll see you all next time. Thank you. Have a good day. Bring the finger position that we're going to be working in to get started in playing piano. In our last video, we learned all about this keyboard geography and where all the notes are. So if you haven't watched that video, make sure you find lesson one. It's a fairly long video, but it will really get you acclimated with where all the keys on your keyboard are. Okay, but today we're going to learn about what we call the C5 finger position. The C5 finger position gets us set up so that we can play some very basic, very easy pieces of music, just to get us started. So how do we get there? Well, first thing we need to do is find the note C. We know by now that all our notes are named with letters of the alphabet, right? A through G. We're going to be focusing on C through G for a while. Don't worry about A and B just yet. So let's think about C. C is going to kind of be our home base for a little while. How do we find C on our keyboard? Well, you see that I have the little note, you know, names of the notes up here. I don't want you to rely on this too much. It's going to be helpful for a little while, but I want you to memorize where these notes are going to be. So I'm going to tell you how to find C. The easiest way is look at the black notes, not the white notes, okay? Now, C is going to be a white note, but I want you to look at the black notes and find the pattern. You see that there are two black notes, then three black notes, then two black notes, and then this would be three black notes. And if I zoomed out, you would see that the entire keyboard has that same pattern. So let's find in the middle of your keyboard, as close to the middle you know, as you can find, your keyboard or your piano, two black notes next to each other. Okay? Now I want you to find the note that's on the left, and then move down to the white key just to its left. I'll say that again. Two black notes together. The black key on the left, find the white key to its left. And that's going to be the note C. And the cool thing about the piano is it's just made up of patterns all the way up and down the piano. So if you can find this C, you can find a C elsewhere on your piano. For example, this one here, right? You've got these two black notes. Look for the white note directly to the left, and there is your C. We call those octaves, right? They should sound the same when they're played together, except one will be lower pitch than the other. And we can do that all the way down our keyboard, right? All the way up and down the keyboard. I know you can't see it right now, but there are many different C's on your keyboard. So for now, we're focusing on the one that's in the middle of your keyboard. Now we found C. That's going to be where your right thumb is going to live. Okay, and remember what we talked about in the last video. Don't play it like this with the pad of your thumb, because that doesn't allow your other fingers to be on your keyboard. So we're going to play with the side of your thumb like this. This allows your other fingers to be right here. Remember to always play with a nice curved hand for mobility. So C, D, our next note, lives between C, between these two black notes, right? D. And then, of course, next would be E on the right side. F lives here, and G would live here. Now, we learned about this in our last video, but now we're going to be able to put our fingers to those notes. So thumb, pointer on D, middle finger on E, ring finger on F, and pinky on G. All right, so you should have some nice mobility there. We're going to do the same thing with our left hand, but because our hands are mirror images of each other, we're going to reverse it. And instead of our left thumb being on C, we're going to put our left pinky on C. All right? And then our ring finger on D, middle finger E, pointer finger F, and thumb on G. Again, using that side of the thumb. So your hand should look like this when you're done. Okay? Now that we've got all that, let's take a look at our music. Now, it's very important that you understand that our music is not going to look like this. These notes kind of look like the notes that we're going to be using, but it certainly won't have the letter names like C, D, E, F, G. We're going to have a different system of notation for being able to read those notes. But for now, we're just trying to get everybody acclimated to the keyboard and playing basic stuff. So our music won't look like this. You may finish playing this song and say, oh boy, playing piano and reading music is a lot easier than I thought it would be. Well, the truth is, it's definitely not going to be this easy. There is more to it. But I still know every one of you can do it. RH is going to stand for right hand, making LH stand for left hand. We won't see that either once we get to music notation. But for now, when you see an RH, know that your right hand is going to play all of this music. And then the next line will be LH, and we're going to play all of this music. Okay, remember that we read music from left to right, just like you would read a book. And then when you get to the end of a line, go down to the next line and start again and read across all the way to the double bar. This double bar signifies the end of a piece of music or a section of a piece of music. Now, we have these areas here where we're going to put notes. And you'll see that these areas are interrupted by these little vertical lines that aren't notes, they're just lines. That divides music into what we call measures. All right? And a measure is going to contain an equal amount of beats as the next measure, until the music tells us otherwise. In this case, we can find four beats in a measure. This note is called a quarter note, and it equals one beat. We talked about that last time, but just to review, each one gets one beat. What's one beat? Whatever we want to make it. So in this case, let's set this tempo meaning speed, and each one of these snaps will be one beat, right? Beat, 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 beat. So every time I play one of these notes, C, D, E, and F, we'd have one beat. When we get to our next measure, this also contains four beats, right? We counted one, two, three, four. Our half note receives double what a quarter note gets, two beats. So two of these will equal four beats. One, two, one, two, or one, two, and then three, four. So to play these G's, we'd play 1, 2, 3, 4, right? It's actually math. It makes a lot of sense. It's basic elementary school math. These numbers up here are for which fingers to use, but you don't really need that, because if you know the C5 finger position and your thumb is on C, you'll automatically know where to put your fingers. It should be very easy. So you really don't have to look at this right now. Later on, that this will become more important. And it's important that you know that not every note is going to have a finger number. And in more advanced music, when we get there, you won't have finger numbers at all. You're just going to know what to do. You won't have to worry about it. Okay, so it's time to play our first piece of music, Etude in C. And like it says here, étude is a French word meaning study or an exercise. You're going to see a lot of études in this book. You'll know that it's just not a full piece of music. It's a little, you know, a study or an exercise. Here we go. Étude in C. We'll get our hands in position, remembering to put our thumb on the C, which again is to the left of these two black notes, and your pinky of your left hand on that C. Curving your fingers, sitting up straight, posture is super important. And I'm going to play it for you once first. So don't play it with me. I want you to watch this time, and then we'll play it together after. I'm going to count every song we play off with a full measure. So I'll usually say 1, 2, ready, play. Okay, 4 beats. 1, 2, ready, play. And then you'd start playing on the first beat of that next measure. Here I go. 1, 2, ready, play. Easy, right? So the right hand again plays that first line, and the left hand is going to play that bottom line. Now it's time for you to play along with me, okay? So let's get ready. I'm excited. It's our first little virtual duet here. So our right hand and our left hand set up, curved, of course, right? Make sure that your thumb of your right hand is on C, all your other fingers follow. And the same thing, your pinky on C, all your other fingers follow. And play along with me. Remember, the black quarter notes equal 1 beat, and the open half notes get 2 beats. Here we go. 1, 2, ready, play. Switch to your left hand. Easy, right? How'd you do with that? I'll bet you did great. But we're always going to make some mistakes, especially early on. So practice, practice, and more practice. So for the purposes of this video, we'll play it together one more time. And then I want you guys, once the video is over, to just practice it and practice it. And one of my students just came up with this saying one day, and I wish I could remember her name, but she wrote it on my whiteboard years ago, and I've used it ever since. And the saying was, practice until it's impossible to get it wrong. And I love that, because that's what making music is all about, is perfecting it. Just like an athlete would work at maybe a basketball player making a foul shot, or a baseball player and hitting the ball square on the bat. Whatever it is that you set out to do in your life, if you practice it enough, if you work at it enough, it becomes that much more easy to achieve. So it's certainly true for playing piano. So practice, practice, practice. Here we go. Let's do it one more time together. Hands are in position. And here we go. 1, 2, ready, play. Now the left hand. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And of course, remember, when we're making this music, you're always in your head counting the number of beats that are in each measure. Later on, there'll be a symbol that's going to tell us how many beats in each measure. But now we can see, right, that there are 4 beats. 1, 2, 3, 4. So in your head, you're always counting. Some people like to tap their foot. For a piano, it might not be the best idea, because once we start using the pedal, you won't be able to do that. But always in your head, be thinking 1, 2, 3, 4. So you count in that you're not getting ahead. All right. Some people like to use a metronome, which is a little device that plays a click. I have one here I can show you. Right. And you could set that click to go faster or slower. And it's a good way to practice, but I don't want you to get in too much of a habit of using that, because some people, you know, start to depend on it to be there. I want to start us out without that metronome so that you can get your own internal metronome and do it in your own head. If you ever need it and you have one on your keyboard or near your piano, you can certainly use it. I know you can get an app on any phone, a free metronome. Just, you know, do a search in the App Store or Google Play, whatever you might be using, and you'll find a metronome that you can use for free. Okay, everybody, that is lesson number two, and I'm so happy you joined me today. I hope you did well, and if you're still struggling, go back in the video and play again, and remember, practice until it's impossible to get it wrong. All right, I'll see you all next time. Thank you. Have a good day.